Well, Tom, tell me about your beast activity last night.
Oh, my God. I was battling it the entire time since as soon as I stepped into my truck. It wanted to hit the nearest bar.
Oh, absolutely.
You know?
Desperate.
Yes. Yes, and I I did everything I could, you know, to say, no, I'm not going to do this, and I did. I made it.
Were you surprised?
Yes, very. The only thing I'm battling right now that really bothers me is the fact that I'm under medication, of course, right now, because I broke my neck and my back.
So what kind of doctor's dope do you take now?
Vicodin. And it just, I am so fed up with it. And the little beast in me keeps screaming, you gotta take those Vicodin right now. You gotta give me some supplements, something, since you're not gonna let me drink.
Mm-hmm.
You've gotta give me those Vicodin. I fought it all night last night. Finally, the pain got to the point where I couldn't, you know, I had no choice. I had a choice, of course, to go, you know, not sleep at all last night or take a couple of Vicodin and get to bed. But my beast wanted more, a lot more.
Well, certainly.
I couldn't sleep.
Yeah.
It wanted to get up and have a drink. Yep. It kept telling me, you know what, hey, these Vicodin aren't enough.
Mm-hmm.
You want that alcohol.
How often do you exceed the prescription dose?
No, I'm very rarely, I should say. Not never. I've told my doctor several times, you know, don't give them to me. At the same time, I scream at him, saying I'm in pain.
Well, there's two of you, yeah. There's two of you.
I decide, no, I don't want it. And I decide that all of a sudden it just comes to the point where I can't handle it anymore, Jack. I get in so much pain, you know, mm-hmm. And that's what I think is still the I.
This is a tricky area.
Yeah, it is.
Because there are legitimate uses for pain-relieving medication, and Vicodin is a pain reliever.
Mm-hmm.
But Vicodin has a side effect that the beast is interested in.
Yes.
The beast is gratified,
mm-hmm,
by the buzz that comes with Vicodin.
It's almost like the alcohol buzz. It really is so close,
mm-hmm,
and it scares the shit out of me.
We say it's all the same thing.
Yeah.
Crack, heroin, mm-hmm, Vicodin, booze, beer, wine, it's
I guess you're right.
The same thing.
You're right, yeah.
Like I said, it's a practical problem.
Yeah, but...
And your beast can have a heyday interpreting your use of Vicodin. You've probably been to AA meetings where they say, oh, you're on something.
Yeah.
Oh, you're taking medications for bipolar disorder. You're taking medications for schizophrenia. Get off that stuff. It's
mm-hmm.
just dope, mm-hmm, is all it is. This is an example of how the beast can make a big deal out of something that has a legitimate purpose in your life. Now, you're, I think, quite right that taking Vicodin is not a good idea in principle, you know, having a predilection to get high, because each time you take a Vicodin, you get a little bit high.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
It is.
On the other hand, if you take the Vicodin at low doses, as prescribed,
right,
and omit doses that you don't need and don't exceed that, you're entitled to the pain relief. There's no reason that you should not take pain relievers.
I agree with that.
Now, there's a lot of mythology that says that if you take a little bit of Vicodin, that'll overwhelm your judgment, and you'll go get drunk or go nuts. And it doesn't really work that way. And you can decide that I will never take more than is necessary for the pain, and sometimes you'll have to endure pain.
Yes.
And here's the other part of it. When your beast finally relents, it's going to relent very shortly, one of the functions of the addictive voice is to amplify all the reasons that it looks good to drink or use drugs. You can stub your toe, and amplify that pain. Go! Yeah. Like this, you know, the beast will take over. And yeah, it hurts, but then the beast makes it excruciating more than it really is to justify drinking. Once your beast knows where it stands, that it's not going to get alcohol, you may notice that pain becomes more tolerable, that your mind will be on different things, and it's more of a nuisance and annoyance than something that lays you out flat. When people pay attention to pain, when they start thinking about the pain, and like if you have a pain in the neck or wherever it happens, your shoulder, and you start dwelling on it, think, oh my God, oh, like that. It does amplify the pain. Probably notice children, if they have like a toothache or something like that, it may be debilitating and they're crying and the whole thing, but then their favorite program comes on television and it's just like Novocaine. The pain is gone. The toothache was real, but it's just less important now. Mm-hmm. There's something else that's going on. So the big plan that we're going to be installing your big plan today will accommodate to the extent that your judgment, your better judgment, thinks that you should take those medications. You can make a big plan. I will never drink or use drugs again. And then, in your better judgment, you can say there are some legitimate uses that I choose Vicodin, or maybe some substitute. There may be other medications that you haven't been introduced to yet. Not just analgesics, but other anti-inflammatories and other things that do not make you high, but sure do kill pain.
Right.
How much aspirin have you tried?
Oh, Tylenol, Motrin,
aspirin.
Advils, aspirin, you name it, everything from there on out. Mm-hmm.
Aspirin's a miracle pain reliever. People have almost forgotten. It doesn't get you high at all. It just gives you relief from pain. It's effective. And the beast can make something like aspirin appear to be ineffective because you take an aspirin, you sit there, and the beast is going...
nothing to it.
Mm-hmm. When's it going to hit? And nothing ever hits. Now, the pain begins to alleviate, but your focus is not on the pain when you take an aspirin. You're waiting for the rush.
Right.
Yeah, the buzz, which never comes. And then the false conclusion is, well, that aspirin doesn't even put a dent in it. Aspirin doesn't work, because the beast is saying, where's the buzz?
Right.
Where's the buzz?
Yeah, it makes total sense. Because, I mean, at the same time, I know that these things are supposed to work.
Aspirin reduces pain right across the board.
Yeah.
So you can try, you'll be able to experiment now to really start looking at drugs for their benefit and not the
high. Because that's all I'm looking at the Vicodin right now is okay, it's going to knock off the pain, sure.
Yeah.
But the high is what gets me off.
Yeah, yeah. This gets back to why people drink in the first place. And you were saying earlier that it gives you relief from bad feelings and so forth. Relief from depression, relief from anger, relief from boredom, relief. But how do you spell relief? You've heard that. Mm-hmm. How do you spell relief? That came from Rolaids.
Commercial,
Rolaids. Yeah. And Rolaids is a remedy for heartburn.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it does.
Right.
And it does exactly what they're advertising it to do. It provides relief from that symptom.
Mm-hmm.
But it has no street value. Rolaids, you can't sell it for more than you pay for it.
Right.
In fact, once you open it, it's probably worthless.
Mm-hmm.
That's not true of street drugs that have this street value or the high. The drugs that make you high then have street value. So Rolaids gives you relief, brings you up to zero. But when you drink, like if you're angry or bored, depressed, whatever, and you drink, you come up from feeling down, but you don't stop at zero.
No.
immediately you go from low to high. You're high. Which is why people who are given medication for like antidepressants, they don't work with addicted people, because people who are addicted aren't interested in becoming undepressed. That isn't their purpose at all. They want to get high. And if antidepressant brings them up and gives them relief from depression, that's no good. And they'll drink on top of the meds, bring them right back down, and they don't work. So psychiatric medications, any kind of medication, it depends upon not drinking in order to get the desired effect. These are simple, very, very simple common sense things, but people get so mixed up in the way that they're thinking about the use of drugs, the use of alcohol, that it's sometimes shocking to hear professional people discussing the matter. They're operating under the illusion that people are using alcohol to cope with life's problems. And that is a far cry from what the real truth of the matter is.
Well, my whole battle last night over this taking the Vicodin thing is just my beast screaming out for that high then.
Yeah, it is.
And if I
say, look how you,
I didn't beat it last night then.
And it says, oh, your neck is hurting. It's terrible. Yeah. It's awful.
It amplifies it so much.
Horrible pain. You poor thing. No person should have to feel pain like you do. Take some Vicodin.
Yeah. So I didn't win last night.
You say you didn't win. What do you mean?
I didn't win the battle.
Well, the key thing is, see, your beast will parlay a thing like this into a problem. Now, as a matter of fact, you have a right to do whatever you want to do. You can drink beer. You can You can Jim Beam or whatever you feel like doing. So your beast will say, "Ah, see, chalk one up. I just beat you, and I'll prove to you that you're going to be powerless and you'll never beat this thing." It uses any sign of failure and weakness to undermine your self-confidence in your ability to get this matter resolved.
So right now I could let this beat me.
Well, your beast is picking up on last night. Oh, I lost. Oh, dang.
I'm not going to let that happen, though. And I see what you're saying. Because right as soon as I, as soon as you told me that this whole thing that we just discussed, I thought, okay, it beat me last night. I felt a little depressed and down on myself.
That's it. That's
okay, and that's the beast doing that to me. Okay.
Lording it over you.
Yeah.
Lording it. Brandishing its brawn and muscle. I beat you, you son of a bitch. Yeah. You think you can mess with me, you watch it. You know, all that. And that's exactly how the beast works.
Right.
It puffs itself up like a blowfish or a peacock. And
Especially in a situation like this.
Its feathers and says, oh, I'm powerful. I'm all powerful. You're powerless before me. And we turn it right around and take control. And because you're always in control, you are perfectly free to decide what prescribed medications you'll take use it as is absolutely needed.
Right.
And you'll probably discover that the pain is not quite the problem that your addictive voice makes it out to be.
Right.
This is purposeful suffering now. Your neck pain is suffering with a purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It gets you there. The more pain you got, the better it is for the beast.
Interesting. I tell you, you know, instead of drinking like last night, I took two Vicodin instead of one, thinking, okay, I'm going to wipe myself out, and it didn't work. I tossed and turned all damn night long because I didn't have that drink, and the beast part of me kept on screaming, you got to get up and have a drink, man.
Yeah.
You know, I want that right now. You know, the Viking is not going to do it tonight.
Well, that's interesting. So the alcohol turns out to be the real pain reliever.
Yes.
The analgesic. Is alcohol an analgesic?
Yes.
It's a rotten, It's a very bad analgesic. It has some analgesic properties. Everybody talks about during the Civil War, they'd take, give a guy a slug of booze and cut his leg off. But he still screamed.
Yeah.
It was not very good. It's like, it hurts, but I don't care as much.
Yeah.
So it's not really an effective analgesic. It's more of an I don't care. You know, screw it all. I don't care if I hurt. And it's primarily for the, in fact, it's exclusively for the sensate signature. That's an expression. The sensate signature, the unique feeling that alcohol gives. It's a very specific feeling. And you're very intimately familiar with it.
Mm-hmm.
The beast just says, feed me.
Yeah.
Do it. Just do it. You had a chance to contend with your beast last night. What else was your beast running by with you?
It was making me really depressed. I was letting it too.
What were you thinking?
I felt really lonely last night, alone. Like I was, like I had nobody, you know, that kind of thing. And it's like you have nobody. You get, you get me so depressed to the point where I wanted to, you know, go to the store and grab a bottle.
Yeah.
To get that loneliness out of me, I wanted to drink.
Was the house empty?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, you were.
I was alone.
Yeah. Well, and what were
common,
you?
You know.
What's how does being alone become a bad thing? What do you think?
It's not to me.
What do you think of though, when you're alone? Last night, what were you thinking of? You were crying.
Dying alone and old and alone. You know, that's my biggest fear in my life is being alone when I die. It just makes me very sad. You know, and I know there's no cure for that. But
well,
the bottle
is interesting.
Keep on running for the drink.
You read the book one or two times, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And right up front, it points out the best place to read this is in a room alone.
Mm-hmm.
Read it alone. Get alone with yourself. And it helps us to understand that we are ultimately alone.
Right.
We came into the world alone. We leave it alone. And making peace with that aloneness is a natural outcome of abstinence. Now, we don't have any remedy for aloneness.
No.
I don't want to convey to you that, well, if you think about reincarnation or you think about transmigration of souls through the channels of the universe and all that crapola, being alone is being alone.
Mm-hmm.
And when you don't drink, you found one way of getting through with it is to, you know, to cry and feel, what, empty or what?
Sad.
Sad?
Just sad.
What is sad about it?
Sad for being lonely.
Lonely is what? What is that?
Nobody to share anything with at the point at that time.
And it's, why is it bad not to have anybody to share with you?
It's not. It's just that it makes me sad, and I don't know. It's not me. I know better.
Yeah.
I know better.
Yeah. But then this voice comes on
and says, "Hey, you know what? You got to get really sad here. I'm going to make you cry." So you run for the bottle.
Yeah.
And it's that beast, the it in me,
telling me
that I'm going to be sad. Yes.
Isn't it horrible to be alone? You poor bastard,
you know?
Yeah.
And the only way to alleviate it is to get a drink.
Get a drink. This is suffering with a purpose.
It was a hell of a battle.
Your beast will create.
Yeah.
This
an entire situation for me just
empty,
to scream for that drink.
Yeah, and all through in the recovery groups and in addiction treatment programs, they talk about the emptiness.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
mm-hmm.
This void, this black, dark hole.
That's exactly
this emptiness.
What I felt last night.
Maybe it's fair to say that you have a hole in your being, in your heart, a hole in your heart. And that this hole in your heart is shaped like a bottle. That you, when you took the bottle out of that, out of you, it left a bottle-shaped hole.
Mm-hmm. I don't want to fill it.
Yeah, well, that's a key question. Because when you don't drink, you feel that empty feeling.
Yes, yes.
And it truly is the dark, dark feelings of the beast.
Everything
that's facing its... See, now this is morbid. That your beast is facing its death. Remember yesterday we talked about this is a survival drive. Mm-hmm. This is survival.
Right.
Life and death. Your beast took an enormous hit yesterday, a direct incoming boom. Got it right in its heart. It knows. It knew last night. This is curtains. This is the way that a rabbit feels when the dog gets its leg. This is it. Now I've really had it. It's dying and is a creature of darkness in the first place. Your beast is.
Yes.
And now it's been faced down with the awful truth that it's not going to survive, and it cries. Real tears. It sobs. It's dying. It doesn't want to die alone. Poor thing. It's crying out for a bottle. Feed me before I die. This is the friend that's been with you and some of the finest moments of your life, really.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the most pleasant, fun moments of your life, and it's given you all those good times. And now, won't you just feed me? I'm dying.
That's just too real. That is so... That's just it.
It's just it. It's always this way. Every single time when we do AVRT, the course, all of these experiences that you're going through, the up feeling, this awful, low, empty feeling, and they talk about it in AA.
Mm-hmm.
Trouble is they live their lives...
But totally differently, though. They live around that emptiness.
They say, this is the reality.
Yeah, and that's not the way it should be.
We have to hold hands and hug and kiss each other.
Everybody have to be together. You have to depend on them, and I don't believe that.
It's pathetic because it's the embodiment
God, I can
of
beat this.
The beast.
I can beat this, Jack.
Yeah.
You just told me something I didn't even realize.
Yeah.
All that sadness and sorrow is not me.
It's not even you.
No.
But see, when it gets the pronoun I...
Yeah.
See, well, once the I... Let me go to addiction now. There's it and you. There's two mentalities here. They are complete personas, not personalities.
Right.
But personas.
Mm-hmm.
It's like one's the party animal, like that, and the other is Tom, like that. Last night, the pronoun I, which is on your... You know how computers work?
Mm-hmm.
It's an icon on the desktop.
Right, I've got one.
Pronoun I is an icon. Your beast went and took control of this command center, this icon. It said, I feel so low.
Yeah.
I feel so awful. I'm so empty. I feel like I'm dying. Please, Tom. Please feed me before I die. It's terrible to die alone like this. Oh, I can't. I'm dying. Get booze. Get booze.
God, it's so true. It's exactly what happened.
And it's been going on for years.
Yeah. Yeah. There are nights where all of a sudden, you know, I get... the world is perfect, everything went great. I get home and all of a sudden the depression lays in and I go run to the store and grab a bottle and feed the beast and it's all fine and dandy then, you know?
Let me ask you something really probing on this thing where you come home and you feel depressed.
Mm-hmm.
You've had a good day.
Yeah.
You come home and all of a sudden you feel like you weigh 400 pounds.
Yeah.
Tired. What comes to mind?
All the sad things that ever happened in my life.
Yeah, and then what finally comes to mind, though?
Have a drink.
Then when you think that, at the moment that it hits you, I'm going to go down and get some booze.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel?
Better.
Much better.
Much just like,
the whole thing disappears. It's like, okay, you got the bottle. It's all planned out. You're going to have a drink. Everything will be fine.
All right. So then you run down to the store. Uh-huh. How do you feel on the way to the store?
Totally relieved.
Totally relieved. Mm-hmm. No. And do you know the people in there?
Somewhat. Yeah. Not a lot. Yeah. You know, they're a regular little corner store and they know me.
You recognize him. Mm-hmm. You walk in and say,
how you doing? Yeah, grab that bottle. Ah, you gonna have a drink tonight? Yeah, sure am, man. Yeah.
When you spot the bottle, is it up on a shelf or in a case?
On a shelf or somewhere, yeah.
You spot it.
There we go.
You spot it.
There we go.
There it is.
That's the ticket. Mm-hmm.
There it is, and you take it home. You mm-hmm. drink it on the way home sometimes?
No, never.
Never do that?
No way.
Okay, now then you take it home and you open it up.
Mm-hmm.
That feels pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
And then you drink it.
And I drink it, and it's like, ah.
Wait, no. Wait a minute. At the moment that the bottle or the glass touches your lips, how are you feeling?
A little anxious at the good. Same time. Yeah. It's like I know everything's going to be all right.
And why are you drinking? What was the reason that
I was sad. You know, or depressed, that's what I was seeing then.
It took you at least a half an hour to go out and back. So for the last half hour, you've been feeling on top of the world.
Exactly, because I thought I knew I was
going to have a drink. Are you drinking to get rid of depression?
No.
Now, this is graphic and vivid. For a half hour at least, and now that can go up to hours.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that could go on for days.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing that you're going to drink brings hope and happiness and is uplifting
mm-hmm.
to know there's a drink on its way.
Mm-hmm.
So when people say, I drink because I'm depressed, do you see the...
It's a negative.
Your blood alcohol content is zero.
Right.
You're feeling wonderful. There's a disconnect there. There is no way that people are drinking to relieve depression.
No. Not at all, because...
The depression is purposeful suffering. To justify
the drink.
The party.
Yeah.
Did you ever have second thoughts and think, you know, I'm not going to do that
anymore? Yes, I have.
And then what happens?
Then I get depressed again.
Golly. It's fun. It's
that battle. It's the beast inside of me saying, hey, you know what? If you don't give me that drink, I'm going to bum you out again, man.
This is what triggered my...
Shit.
I finally began to notice what you're noticing right now. And I cracked up when I first realized.
It's hilarious.
I was debating.
I'm sitting there crying all the freaking time over nothing. Because that damn, because I want a drink.
Yeah.
That's all I'm really crying over, because it wants a drink.
It wants a drink.
And as soon as I say no to it, it's going to make me cry again. Oh, man.
Yeah. That's the way it works.
What a realization.
It is.
What a realization.
It's a piercing insight.
I'm not depressed at all. My life is great, Jack.
I was very concerned when I quit drinking. I thought, you know, I may end up being depressed the rest of my life. And I would vacillate, you know, is it really worth it to quit drinking when I might be depressed? And the interesting thing is I was a real sad sack back in those days.
Mm-hmm.
I was like with the black cloud over my head.
Right.
And since I stopped drinking, I have been unable to get depressed. I can't, no matter what happens, I think I could really get depressed. No, I couldn't. It's bad enough without getting depressed.
Yeah, yeah.
So the way it turns out is that even though addicted people are sad sacks, you know, it's a life sucks mentality mm-hmm. that they're carrying mm-hmm. around with them, and only booze can bring
a little light into
my life, you know, the whole thing. When people quit and really mean it, so that there's no ambivalence anymore,
right?
The clouds part and the storm is over. The whole thing is washed up and you just resume being whoever you are, who disappeared when you fell in love with the alcohol.
Oh, man, this is too much.
So that's the void, the spiritual sickness. The spiritual sickness that they talk about, this is a spiritual program.
Mm-hmm.
It's odd that they would use the word spiritual, because to fill the hole left by spirits, do you know what I mean? You take away the spirits and they got a spiritual problem. they do got, your beast has a spiritual problem.
Yeah. It's not getting the drink.
It's not getting the spirits.
And they make it sound like you have to have so much support, and you don't. It's all within yourself.
Yeah, now support has got to be the worst. It's not only that it's irrelevant, it stops people from taking personal responsibility for their own conduct.
Right.
This is the quicksand of the recovery group movement, and you can sink into that and never come out again. You get submerged, and everybody who's under says, gee, it's great being under, isn't it? And that's what happens. The people are then afraid, once they get submerged in the recovery group, they're afraid to leave it because they're told, if you could have quit, you would have quit, but you didn't, so you can't. And now you aren't drinking, and the reason you aren't drinking is because you're in AA group of support, and if you leave us, you will drink again. This is the embodiment of the beast.
Yeah.
This is the beast talking through the addictive voice. We call it the 12-step program or the psychological recovery groups do exactly the same thing. Let me ask you, what is your plan for the future use of alcohol?
Absolutely none.
You know, absent from that declaration was the pronoun I.
Yeah.
This is typical. The beast has taken that piece off the board and said, it's mine. Mm-hmm. That is my piece. Now you go ahead and say any damn thing you want to.
I will not drink again.
Absent from your declaration is the bullet word, never. It's the only word in the English language that it truly fears. Mm-hmm. So it took that piece off the board. Now it has I and never. Mm-hmm. Out of the equation. We have five words in the big plan. It's a very forceful declaration. It's a vow.
I will never drink again.
Yeah, I will never drink again.
That's what my plan for the future is.
Okay, let me ask you then, what is your plan for the future use of alcohol?
I will never drink again.
How's that feel?
Scary.
Are you taking your deep breaths?
Yeah.
What are they feeling? What are these feelings?
Because it's unsure.
Are you?
Yes, I am. I'm very unsure of it right now. But I will never drink again.
Okay. This is the crucial moment for Tom and also for you. Tom just made his big plan, and now it's your turn. When you think about never drinking again, how does that feel? Do you feel something cringe inside of you? If you do, that's good. That's your beast. And it's very difficult to say goodbye to something that you love. And never is a long, long time. It's a long, dry spell. Never. Just think of never again feeling the gentle buzz of a brew or of a mixed drink or a glass of wine. Now, think of how it would feel if you knew for certain that you would never drink or use again. If you knew for a fact that you're fully recovered, a normal person on a level playing field in life, go ahead and imagine what it would feel like to already be recovered. If that feels good, good for you. It is a wonderful, uplifted feeling to finally get rid of a problem. It's been causing such misery, depression, anxiety, the hassles of being addicted, the horror of it all. Go ahead. Feel the good feeling. It's called hope. It's called relief. It's called freedom. You see, there's two ways of looking at the same thing. first you feel bad about permanent abstinence, then you feel good about permanent abstinence. Your beast feels very bad about permanent abstinence. You feel very good about permanent abstinence. So whose way is it going to be? Your beast's way or your way? It's entirely up to you. And either way you decide is exactly the way it will be. So think it over right now and make up your mind. Time's up. If you've decided that it will be your way, that you will never drink again, then let's set that decision down in cement. I'm going to ask you the most important question in your life. Are you ready? What is your plan for the future use of alcohol and other drugs? Still wavering? Still a little undecided? Well, here's what a big plan sounds like. I will never drink again. Each word is important. First, the word I is the most important word in the English language. I is the self. It's you. And I is the command symbol that operates your hands and your feet. All of your voluntary behavior is controlled by the use of the pronoun I. Will is the foundation of freedom. Will is what makes you a free moral agent, capable of knowing and choosing between right and wrong. Will is the fulfillment of your desire for a better life. The word will is ridiculed by the beast because it knows your will can destroy it. The word never is the only word in the English language that your beast fears. Never is the stake in its heart, the fatal blow that kills the beast. Never is complete, final, and lethal to your beast. Each time you think the word never, your beast cringes and quakes with fear. Fear of you. Drink means to use drugs of any kind, and alcohol is a drug. Drink is the sacrament of the beast, its first love, which it will have you betray all others to have. Drink is the cause of practically every problem in your life. The word again simply means that I am making this decision on personal experience. I am very experienced in the use of alcohol and other drugs, and the balance between the pleasure and the pain has forever changed. Again means I will never again repeat the act of self-intoxication because for me it is wrong. We who have recovered know what we're talking about, and this is the way an effective big plan sounds. I will never drink again. I would like you to practice saying your big plan right now. This is so that you can get the feel of it and see how your beast tries to interfere. Go ahead and say it out loud right now. I will never drink again. Did you feel the inner resistance? Did the beast change the words around, like, I won't drink again, or I don't want to ever drink again? Did the beast take the pronoun I out of your big plan? Did you hear the beast talk back to you? Did it call you a liar? Did it tell you this is silly? Did it tell you that you'll never make it? Did it remind you of all the times you failed? These are very typical examples of ways that the beast interferes with the big plan. It's trying to perpetuate itself. Okay, enough practice. It's time to go ahead right now and make your big plan. It's like going off the high dive. You don't know it's safe until you take the plunge. I ask you again, what is your plan for the future use of alcohol and other drugs? I'm going to assume that you've made your big plan. If you haven't, you can hit the rewind and go back to where I came in with Tom a few minutes ago and do a rerun. Assuming you have made your big plan, welcome to the real world of rational recovery, and congratulations on your big plan. I hope you feel very good about your decision. If you feel awkward right now, that's natural. As I said before, permanent abstinence feels both ways, but right now, while this is all fresh, think about what you've done. Think about what this means to you, to your loved ones, and think about what this means in terms of your future. Think of what you want out of life and how your big plan can get you there. Let yourself feel good. And when you feel those good feelings, trust it. Trust those good feelings because they're based on reality. Let me remind you that the good feelings that you have about your big plan are not a pink cloud, and they're not a honeymoon that's going to pass. And it's not denial of anything. Find those good feelings of relief and hope and fan them into a roaring fire. Those feelings are you, your original self, the person who as a younger person was all excited about the possibilities of adult life, full of hope for the rewards that come with adult responsibility. These feelings are a part of AVRT-based recovery, and they're so predictable that I've named them something: the abstinence commitment effect. You have aced this course, and you are fully recovered from your addiction, if you say so. The abstinence commitment effect never goes away. It's been nearly two decades for me since I quit drinking, and I still feel very good about the fact that I will never have new problems related to my drinking. So enjoy. It's your reward for accepting responsibility. You might want to take a short breather here, step outside, have a cup of coffee, or just sit for a few minutes and reflect on what you've accomplished. When we get back, we'll get back to Tom and me and some of his struggles with uncertainty about his big plan. In the meantime, while you bask in the satisfaction of being recovered, just listen to what your beast has to say about what you've just done. See you later.